Hello, I'm Paul Tagosch. I'm talking about USB and how to handle USB, some informations about it, to understand the concept behind the specification, and to just get some kind of overview of everything with some ideas at the end. I started first a little bit of introduction to USB, mostly naming, then some comparisons based on the performance and other things. Then we go down the rabbit hole, how USB works. And then, like almost every embedded developer knows, life is pain. We must care about every little thing. And in USB, it's not different, just more complex. And the end is the what if, what can be done? Introduction. First, there was USB 1. USB 1 was the first official standard. There were some better versions, but that's the first really used one. After that, they invented USB 2. Same, faster, better, like everything if the number goes higher. And then there was USB 3. The same thing again. Now with more blue connectors, but it's mostly the same. And then came USB 3.1. And then they had the glorious idea to rename USB 3.0 to 3.1 Generation 1. And the new standard is Generation 2. Nobody knows why, but they defined it this way. And with USB 3.2, they had the same idea again, just more complex. Now we have USB 3.2, Gen 1.1, Gen 2.1, and 1.2, and 2.2. And again, faster, and again. And just this month, they announced USB 4. Cables in USB have a naming convention. The connection to the host device is a USB type A connector. You can see the one from USB 3 there in the picture. And everybody knows the problem with USB A. You need three tries. Earlier, it will not work. The other side of the cable is called USB Type B. It's in this case again USB 3. And you connect it to the device that you want to connect. And then they had the glorious idea to create a complete new connector for USB because everyone tries to three times to connect the cables. It's annoying. And they wanted more power through the connector. So they invented USB 3 because C, I mean, USB C is because A, B, C. They were very creative with the names again, but this time it makes sense. Cables with USB C are same on both sides in the most cases. There are adapters too, but normally you have the same connector on two sides. And then we have something called USB OTG or on the go. It's some kind of special USB B connector, but you can use this to use a device as a host. In the most cases, it's known for things like a mobile phone, where you want to add maybe a mouse because your touch screen broken. I saw many funny pictures about that in the internet. And or mass storage, like a SD card reader or something like this. I even saw an adapter for Commodore 64 disket because someone wanted to play the games on his phone and needed the games. Yeah. Let's go to Act One, comparisons of the different USB standards. Indeed, we had in USB 1.0 low speed and full speed. The low speed was very, very slow. The full speed was already 1 MB/s. And that was the first real difference. You can have different speeds on the same device. Then in USB 2, they added a new speed called high speed, sometimes referred to high with only two letters. In other versions, they renamed it to high with four letters. Again, funny naming conversions. And you could use 40 Mbps. I'm not sure anymore. Okay, make. You called it megabytes, the megabit. Okay. No, no, it's speed that you can should get in the best case. Question in the room, or the correction in the room, was that I failed to difference between megabyte and megabit. It's megabit there, and it's not fast. Even then, you can't get the speed correct. What if I turned it around again? sorry, meg. Yeah. But that are official numbers that I got from the internet. Yeah, that are just official numbers. The internet was wrong again, sorry. So just see the numbers as some kind of relative values. In 3.0, they extended the speed and called it super speed. So full speed is not the full speed, high speed is higher, and super speed is better than higher speed. And because they couldn't get better names, they called a newer speed super speed plus. And with USB 3.2, they even extended it, but they had no new names, so they still call it super speed plus. Yeah. So we have now super speed plus in 3.2, and it's very, very fast compared to the other standard. Now to the power supply. USB 1.0 had only a 0.5 watt with 5 volts. In USB 2, they extended it to 2.5 watt. USB 3 extended it even more. And then they had the glorious idea to use the connectors for charging of phones and other battery devices. That's why they defined a specification called USB battery charging. Now you have still 5 volts, but more ampere, and the power, the maximum power, is the maximum allowed for the connectors. The connectors were different defined than the standard itself to be usable in the future, and that's the end of the cycle. I already told that we had something called USB Type-C. They even defined their own specification for this. They can use 3 ampere with 5 volt, so 15 watt. And now it gets a bit strange. We have now USB power delivery. It's their own specification that can extend the others. And in type C, we can now get 20 volts. And with the 5 ampere, and we extend even the current to 5 ampere and get 100 watt if we want. Then I saw some funny things on Twitter from some crazy guys. They built their own power adapter. It's USB-C to two different things. One time to a normal industry connector, and on the other side to just a LED strip. That's why there are three big soldering places. That's the produced one. And another guy from the same hackerspace had the idea to charge his phone with it. So he built a simple adapter for this. And now he's charging his notebook with USB 3. And it's now really modern, cutting edge technology for his old notebook. It's some kind of funny for me. Now to the pins itself. In USB 1 and 2, we had only 4 connections. 2 were the power supply and 2 were the data lines. It's a differential pair, so it's just 1 data. So the same bit is standard over the 2 cables connection. Then they created some kind of smaller form factor called mini USB and micro USB. It's mostly the same. They just added a new pin. It's called the ID pin. And with this, they can detect the already told USB OTG. So it's a host device or still a normal USB device. And then USB 3 was there, and they added 5 more. We have a ground in the middle, that's the 7 in the picture. And the 5 and 6 is a new high-speed data line, but this time unidirectional. The other data line works in both directions. This data line only in 1, and the 8 and 9 is the same in the other direction. And then we have USB-C, and this gets really, really crazy at this point. The connector can be used on both sides, so you can turn it around. We have in the middle the data pin on the other side of the connector too. The ground is outside, and the A1, B9, the A4, and the B4 are the voltage. The high-speed data lines that I just announced in USB 3 are A2, A3, and B11, A10 and A11 are the other side of the connector too. And you don't use every pin on this connector in the simplest way. Because if you use the connector, it's easier to the device to check how it's connected with the DC pins. And then he knows what pin to drive and that he will use. It's the most simple solution, but as I already told, USB-C is some kind of a special kind of connector. They wanted to extend this. In USB 3.2, we already find out that we have 2 We have this two connection, and that just means we use the TX pins and X high speed pins, but everyone. So not only the four that we normally use, we will use the other ones too to extend the performance. We can use an USB power delivery specification, the CC pins to handle shake the power consumption. In the primitive version of USB-C, you just use resistors, and that's done. With the special cables with the own integrated circuit, you have some kind of handshake with the cable too, and then you can use 20 volts. It gets more complicated. We have still legacy modes where we just use the data pins, the D plus and minus. We have alternate modes new to USB 3. Alternate modes just means we can reuse the high-speed data pins to other functions. We can mix them up, so you can still use your USB 3 device as a USB 3 device, but you can use the other pins for something different. There are some standards for mostly video signals, but not every video signal just needs this amount. Sometimes you want more, or you want to create a custom alternate mode, then you can do this. It's allowed with the specification. You can mix them up like you want. You use the SBU pins, that's for sideband use, to communicate for the alternate mode. And yeah, it's really, really, really complicated, and you can use everything with it if you want. And I'm pretty sure they will extend that even more. And because it's such a complicated connector, there was a story at the beginning of the Nintendo Switch. They released the Switch, and some people thought, I need to recharge the battery, but I don't have a recharger. What can I use? Maybe I connect it to my MacBook because it's a host. It may be slow, but maybe I can play it some minutes later. Yeah, long story short, it didn't work well at the beginning because the Switch was charging the MacBook and not otherwise around. They fixed it with the later patch, but it's a still funny story. Now down the rabbit hole. If we register our USB device to the host, like our computer, we must give him information about the device. And this is not even everything that we are sending. We have a really big number of some kind of bytecode, mostly bytes, but not everywhere. And sometimes there are flags, also bitwise flags. And it's really a pain to do this by hand. But normally the user don't see this. It's only for developers interested. And I just cut the small amount out of it. We have that's the beginning of this big messages. We have at the beginning some kind of length. We have a descriptor type. We have the USB version that we are using. We have a device class. The device class is saying the host what we are using, as what kind of device it is. It can be a communication device. So we call communication devices CDCs, because communication device class, that's nothing else than a normal serial port over USB. But often vendors don't want this, so they use a different class and define the other parts itself. Yeah, there are different things. So if you want only one simple device, like a serial port, that's the most developer thing, it's the first goal, you just specify the device class with the wanted class, like the CDC that I said. If you want more, it gets more complicated. You must define a custom class, a vendor class, or a composite class. But you are saying the host that you have more interfaces, and then these interfaces are explained in the interface association descriptors, and these are your devices that you use. So if you want two serial ports on one USB device, you use a custom class or a composite class, and use the interface association descriptors with the device class of the CDC. And I could now explain almost every flag and byte in this descriptor, but I think everyone wants then to sleep here in the room. I already see that Jens tries it. So I will not talk about this. Everyone who wants to get more information can read them in the internet. It's much easier for everyone, I think. And to explain how the devices work, I must first explain endpoints. Endpoints are buffers in the device itself. It's like your FIFO in your UART connection or SPI. If you use SPI, you use FIFOs for this too. And these endpoints are exactly the same. There's only one difference. Endpoints can be an in endpoint, and so you receive data or you are sending data, and the endpoints can, with the same number, can be used for two directions, but they are different buffers. So you can have an special endpoint one that's the input, and you can have an endpoint one that's the output, and they are completely different endpoints. And in the descriptor that you saw some slides before is in the endpoint zero, that's the main configuration endpoint that gets asked, and we are sending them data as a host to accept the descriptor or not, because maybe we already use too much power, so we can't say, no, it's okay, no, sorry, we don't have enough power. But normally you need some other endpoints for your device, because you want to send something, you want to receive something, and you can't use endpoint zero. In USB 1, there was already defined the lowest speed possible in the USB standards, and you can exactly use two more endpoints. And with two more endpoints, I really mean two. They don't care about the number, but they care how many you are. You can use two inputs, you can use two outputs, or a mix of both, and not more. With every other speed, you have more freedom. You can use every other endpoint address, because zero is already reserved, but you have 1 to 15, and you can use it for both directions. So you get 30 possible endpoints, if your device can handle it. Often, the hardware don't accept that many endpoints in both directions. Many hardware chips say, okay, this endpoint can only be used as output or only as an input. So in the most cases, you don't have that much as a developer, but I don't know why you should need that many endpoints. Something went wrong. Okay. Now we are in X3. Life is pain, and that was not the pain before. Normally, some weeks ago, I thought if I want a simple serial port for my device, for my microcontroller, I will use the FT232. It's a special USB chip to use a UART to USB adapter. They cost, if you buy enough, €1.50. That's not many. If you just produce 20 devices, that's not worth the work. And somehow I thought this is the normal way for the most developers, but it's not true, not anymore. STM, the developer of most of the microcontrollers today with on ARM basis, got a nice GUI tool. It's not perfect, but it works. And there you can just click your serial port or audio device or mass storage device. And so the FT trick, it's not worth the time or the money, because if you just need a simple serial port, you can use that in the most cases. So I wanted to rant here, but it didn't work. But I was not completely wrong, because it's just the simplest case. You have one serial port or one audio device or one mass storage and nothing else. Then this solution works perfectly, can be just used in some minutes. If you already done this before, it's a thing of seconds. But if you want two serial ports, because of reason, maybe for a firmware update or a special function or something else, that is not that easy. You can still implement it your way, but then you must implement the descriptor by hand, or clone it from some other guy in the internet, but then you must trust him that he don't make a mistake. And yeah, it's really a pain to write this. So I can just say, you don't want to do this. But then I was like, what could we do? I had the glorious idea to implement it in TMP. That was the first idea for the talk. And I wanted a serial port. I'm using an alias to the type. Then I make my special device object with a serial port inside this. Behind this is TMP magic, so it's sounds crazy and only Odin will understand this, but in reality it's really, really, really simple, and I'm pretty sure everyone in this room will understand my ideas behind this. But it's just a simplified thing. I'm not really doing a real stack, just some function codes that get called. And this way I could theoretically already wrap some kind of the USB stack of STH. And yeah, then I have this object in the second line. The third line is just init my device, and then everything should start. I had this output, and because I didn't know what should I use. Should I make a new wrapper for every possible hardware abstraction, or just use one example of one hardware abstraction? And I use the STHL because they could be generated very fast, and I use this as a simple printout. And yeah, this function is in my code. Init is initializing the device. Register class would use the descriptor that was already defined on this device, then register some call flags in the next line, and then really start the device. For HIT, it was almost the same, just the human interface device, like mouse and keyboards. But the idea behind this example was, maybe I can combine this, because the composite classes are hard to explain, in my opinion, in the now known HALs. And I thought, okay, if I can just put a serial port inside this, or a human interface device and something else, maybe I can add more than one. We have radiotic templates, we can theoretically do this. And with some lines of code more, I implemented some kind of implementation. And we see many of the NAR class and one bar class. And my output was this. I initialized the USB device, then I was marking some kind of composite class. I would implement there the interfaces at this point. And then the output of my new custom classes were na 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 Batman. And then I'm ending the wrapper and start the device. So it's not really a function, but I think I can, and that explains what I'm thinking about, what can be done. And in my opinion, it's really not that much to implement for this. It's not completely easy because you have many chip vendors. You maybe want to use a HAL still in your code. Maybe you will change the HAL. And then the device must support this. One problem is the buffer size for USB. If you have many devices, you must make them smaller. And this handling makes everything complex. But in the end, it's not that much to do. What else can be done like that? We can define the size of the descriptors at compile time. If you are writing a descriptor by hand, you must write the size correct. If you make it too small, the descriptor fails, and you failed with your device. If it's too long, it's bad too. Hopefully, no driver crashes. I think I showed that it's easier to cascade devices with this idea. And if you have subclasses that you can just throw in and have examples of some main classes, it's, in my opinion, easier with these ideas. And here is some example of the HTHAL, also the STMHAL. It was used, and this is a real example from the files that was generated by this GUI tool. But if you want to modify it, it gets hard. And as you can see, it's just a descriptor for one simple device, and it goes on and on and on. So nobody really wants to do this, and we have many links everywhere. Okay, one guy in the audience said, if you modify code and then use the GUI tool, again, it can destroy everything. And yeah, it's true. I had already the problem, but if you just use a new project and know what you want to do, it's some kind of work. But I didn't want to rant on this part, I just wanted to talk about USB. Something is here. That was my talk. Ask some questions.